Hi everyone, this is Sofia Smallstorm offering you another podcast. It's the month of September. We've just passed Labor Day, Sweatshop Day. I don't know what to call it. We're increasingly having to labor in this world to get through the denseness of what seems to be descending on us. But there are ways that we can burrow into the content and explode it with new insights. And I have here a guest today that is going to do exactly that. And he was a non-believer in this concept at one time. In fact, I remember talking to him and he was very, you know, he had undisguised scorn for this particular notion. And then he has completely about-faced and he's here to share his path, his discoveries of this rather huge discussion, truncated, abbreviated as PID, which also stands for pelvic inflammatory disease, but he is not a gynecologist. So I'm going to bring back one of my favorite people in the world, Mike Williams.
PID is Paul is dead, Paul McCartney. And thank you for having me come back on the show. It's always a pleasure to talk with you about whatever topic we decide to talk about. I think this one is going to be of keen interest to many people.
So, Mike, I remember, I don't even know when it was, a year ago, and somebody sent me some Paul thing, and I sent it to you because I see you. I mean, I'm looking at you now on Skype, and you've got this Beatles stuff behind you in your studio. And I thought, well, I mean, I'd like to know what Mike thinks about this subject of Paul having been replaced. And you immediately, you swatted at that like it was a gnat that had arrived on your screen too many times. And I said, all right, well, if that's what you think, I was going to board that particular train car with you. Because not that I'm slavishly devoted to what you think, but, you know, I have respect for what you think. And that was that. So then suddenly you about-faced. Why don't you tell us how that happened?
Well, you're absolutely right. It was about a year ago because the whole Paul is dead conspiracy was being kicked around again. And it comes up every once in a while, every few years it pops up. It's been in play for about 50 years. And I remember back when I was in high school, Sophia, back in 1976, when I really got into it. I was about 17 years old at that time. I knew all the clues or most of the clues. I had all the albums and I even organized a Paul is Dead presentation at my high school. I went to high school on Long Island in New York. It was very well attended, I might add. And I did not believe that he was replaced. I thought that that he did have some kind of plastic surgery. I thought that it was perhaps because he was in a car crash. So never discounted the fact that there was a car crash. And so, you know, they had to fix him up. In the email I sent you, I guess about a year ago, one of the sticking points that I had was being a musician myself and being a guitar player, and I'm right-handed. The conspiracy was always that the guy that replaced Paul McCartney was right-handed, and then he had to learn to play left-handed. And I just found that to be, not that it can't be done, but it's an extremely daunting task to switch from naturally right-handed to then play left-handed. And not just play left-handed, but be very, very adept at playing left-handed. So that was always a stumbling block for me, a big one. I did see the pictures on the internet later on when we had internet. I never thought that there wasn't the possibility of lookalikes or body doubles because it is show business. And I've explained to a lot of people when the Beatles first hit the scene in 1963, they were a boy band. That's what they were. They were the 1963 version of Backstreet Boys. We'll pick another boy band, a recent one. I'm probably dating myself with those guys too. So for the longest time, you know, every once in a while I would pop my head back into the conspiracy, and I have a lot of books and that go back way back. I have Life magazines that go back to 1964, 65, 1966, and I would take a look. And I would see anomalies, but I guess, you know, I rationalized it. To be honest with you, I rationalized it by saying, well, something must have happened. There had to have been an accident, and he had to go under the knife and have surgery. And so it was, now that I look at it, it was a rationalization. And I just honestly, in my heart, I didn't believe that they would be able to pull something off like this. I just believed that they would not be able to keep the secret, that too many people would know, the word would get out. And then, you know, there were all these clues that were coming out on the albums. And, you know, my thinking was, well, if you're going to hide something, why would you talk about it? Why would you put clues out there? So I thought what was going on was it was a marketing gimmick. And it did indeed. The whole Paul is dead rumor, that conspiracy drove Beatle record sales through the roof, especially in 1969 when Abbey Road was released. Over time, though, and I would say probably over the last 10 to 15 years, there were a couple of things that caught my eye, and I was becoming more suspicious of McCartney's behavior, because in my view, it was becoming more eccentric over the years. And what I mean by that is that we have to remember that when we talk about John Lennon and Paul McCartney, we're talking about two guys that were childhood friends, and they were very, very close. And then I started seeing, as time went on, especially after John Lennon had passed away, that McCartney, the person that refers to himself or calls himself Paul McCartney, was positioning himself as a primary creative force of the Beatles. And again, especially after Lennon had passed away back in 1980. And essentially, he was putting the theme across that he was the Beatles. He was the creative force behind the Beatles. And I always thought that was kind of odd. I thought to myself, well, you know, if you were really good friends and you were childhood friends and you were in this great band together, why would you start off on that track? Why would you go down that path? And then several years back, he attempted to, at least he was floating a trial balloon to get the song credits changed from Lennon McCartney to McCartney and Lennon. In other words, he would have his name first for the songs that were essentially his. So as an example, Let It Be is a Paul McCartney song, but the credits say Lennon and McCartney. He wanted it to be McCartney and Lennon because he wrote Let It Be. Lennon wrote Strawberry Fields Forever, so that would read Lennon and McCartney. So he was trying to get that going. And if recollection serves me correctly, Yoko Ono stopped that right in its track. So that didn't go anywhere. And of course, then he was knighted. He's now Sir Paul McCartney, which now, you know, you're starting to get this inclination that he's part of the whole elite apparatus. Another event that I thought should have raised eyebrows, it did with me, was when he was married to Heather Mills. And that had become an enormous mess. She was out there, and she didn't get specific because she would have gotten herself in tremendous legal problems, but she was claiming that there was this monstrosity of a deception going on. And so, as most people know who follow the Beatles or follow McCartney, that ended in a high-profile divorce in 2008. Heather Mills received $50 million from that settlement. So there was things that were just kept, you know, kind of coming along. And I'll get into some more, what I call close calls, that maybe a lot of people don't know about, but is in the book. And so what I'm leading to here, and I know I'm being a little long-winded, is, and I'll show you the book here, Sophia, because I know you could see it. The book is called The Memoirs of Billy Shears.
And this is... just to stop you for a minute.
Yeah.
It was upon reading this book that the case was settled for you once and for all, right?
Case closed. This book is written by the man that calls himself James Paul McCartney. His name is Bill Shepherd, William Shepherd. So he wrote this book, and it's a tell-all book. It was released in September of 2009. In fact, it was September 9th, 2009. So it's 090909. So we're going to get into some of the numerology and the Masonic influences that just have encapsulated this entire conspiracy.
You're waving that book at me, and I'm seeing that it has an author, this Thomas E. U. Harriet.
Yes. Yes.
Now, you're telling me it was written by this Billy Shears, who is Paul McCartney, but then why does it have that guy as the author?
Okay, so the Thomas E. U. Harriet, he's an author. We would refer to him, I guess, as an author, but It's a very interesting title that they've given him for this book. They call him the Encoder. And I'll get into that in a little bit. But Thomas E. U. Harriot, I looked him up, and it's very little on him on the internet. And what I did find, believe it or not, I found in the description box on Amazon.com if you go to buy this book. So, and I'll read this. Thomas E. U. Harriot, author, poet, philosopher, speaker, and teacher, earned his Bachelor of Arts degree in English at Brigham Young University in Utah and his Master of Education degree at Westminster College in Salt Lake City. U. Harriot is a California native, but lived in Utah while writing and encoding the memoirs of Billy Shears. Now, we know that, I know you and I know, maybe the audience doesn't, so let me explain. Brigham Young University is owned and operated by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, which is the Mormons. And the Mormons are totally and completely linked to the Freemasons. In fact, the Freemasons created the Mormon religion. So we're beginning to get here now. We have this gentleman, Thomas E. U. Harriot, being called the Encoder slash author. He is, out of Brigham Young University. He wrote the book while he was in Utah. So I'm going to make a leap of faith. I don't think it's a big one that he's a Mason and a Mormon. And so he's involved in this project. Now, the reason
okay,
why...
What's an encoder?
Okay, so the encoder in the book, on each page, there's 666 pages in the big book, in the memoirs book. The smaller book is called Billy's Back. This is the abridged version. It's about 250 somewhat pages. I read this first just to get a taste of what it was all about, to make sure, you know, I didn't waste my money on a bigger book. And this was so unbelievable, an unbelievable read, that I went and bought the big book, 666 pages. So 666 again, right? So we're talking about the book being released on 09-09-09, 666 pages. And the reason why they call him the Encoder is because in the book, and I'll show you this, Sophia, hopefully you can see this, and I will put a copy of this in the video when I do it, because I'll put all the visuals in here. But what you can see here is, here's a page, any page I just picked out of the book. Now, I don't know if you can see this, but there are bolded words throughout that page. So what the Encoder did, what Thomas E. U. Harriot did, was there were words that were selected throughout the text on every single page, all 666 pages, that essentially give the reader a synopsis or a brief take on what, I guess, the premise or the thoughts of William Shepherd or Bill Shepherd, what they are. Okay, so as an example, I don't know if this is making sense, but on page 108, I'm going to read this. So it says, I play the part of Paul McCartney for this fine, long-running show, but I am still Bill. Rightly so, all performances require performers to adopt personas fitting each specific show. It is not dishonest to have one role with a name in one film and another of each in some other show. It is all showbiz. Every role has its own name. Playing the part of Paul is the same. For the Beatles, my name is Paul. My solo Paul work is a spin-off of the Beatles act. In other roles, I go by other names. So essentially, this guy Bill Shepherd, you know, Bill Shepherd is playing a part. He's playing a character, if you will. Now, I just read you that paragraph. So now, in that paragraph, he bolded out specific words. I'm going to read the bold out words. I play the long-running show. All performances require each to have one role with a name. In some other show, every role has its own name. The part of Paul is the same. I go by several names. So it might sound a little choppy, but what it's doing is it's essentially summarizing the page. And they're doing it by encoding certain words within the book in order to do that. And again, like I said, this is done throughout all 666 pages of the book. Now, I guess the point being that it's extremely intricate. So an enormous amount of time and effort went into putting this book together. Aside from the fact that Bill Shepherd, who plays the part of Paul McCartney, had to compile all this, and he had to have started this years before this book was released, and then connecting with Thomas E. U. Harriot to encode the entire book. So that's why they call him the Encoder. But he is, for all intents and purposes, I guess we can call him the author of the book.
All right. So where did you, Harriet, the book is written in what we call first person, I.
Yes.
And presumably people who write I books are writing the book themselves. But in this case, he had a ghost writer who's given credit, Thomas E. U. Harriet, who has done this bolding, which allows for a kind of speed reading of every page. But so you, Harriet, knows this Billy Shears guy, right?
Yes. Yeah. He apparently, I mean, he has to know him. If he didn't know him, if he didn't know Bill Shepard beforehand, he certainly knows him now, because they had to work very, very closely over, I would think, a long period of time to put the book together.
So you are 100% sure that this was a collaborative effort. Is that documented somewhere?
The publishing of the book is very low key. It's very unassuming. So in other words, if you go onto Amazon, it was published in CreateSpace, which is an independent publishing platform. Now, some people might say, well, that's crazy. You know, I mean, the guy who's playing Paul McCartney with all his money, he would do something like that. But folks also have to understand that, and I'm going to call him Bill for now on, because he's not Paul McCartney. His name is Bill Shepard, William Shepard. Bill has done various projects, many projects over his career, where he has taken on different roles, different personas. As an example, he did an album going back many years ago called Percy Thrillington. And nobody at the time knew who Percy Thrillington was, but then later on it came out that people, of course, thought that Shepard was McCartney, that it was McCartney. He had put an album together, and it was an orchestration rendition of his Ram album. So he came out with Ram as his second album after his first solo release, which was called McCartney. So after McCartney, he released Ram. And so years later, what he did was he took the Ram album and he put an orchestra behind it. And it was a almost like a classical rendition of McCartney's rock album called Ram. He also released a CD several years back called The Fireman. And, you know, this was another CD where he was, his name was downplayed. He didn't stick McCartney all over. It was just called The Fireman. But this was another project that he was involved in. Now, the one thing, though, is that the book is published by Pepper Press. Now, I took a look at who was Pepper Press. And it's in the book, and I also checked it elsewhere on the internet. It's a subsidiary of MACCA Corporation, M-A-C-C-A Corporation, MACCA Corporation. On the website, on the Billy Shears website, it says most of the material for this book is based on words by the current Paul McCartney, formerly known as William Shepard. However, U. Harriet took liberties with dialogue and other elements, ensuring that this book is a work of historical fiction. Some parts are exact quotes, some quotes were modified to fit the code or the narrative, and sometimes the setting was modified. Now, the book had to be written as historical fiction, and this is explained in the book very thoroughly, because of non-disclosure and confidentiality agreements that Bill Shepard has signed. So he can't let the cat out of the bag. So he's got to camouflage it to some degree in order to put enough fiction into the writing so that he can't get sued and be in breach of contract and get himself in all kinds of trouble. But he makes it very clear that the vast, vast majority of the book is very accurate and it is historical.
All right. So who makes that clear, you, Harriet, or Shepard?
It's made clear in the book, but also if you go to the website, if you go to billyshears.com, and if you click on to the right, there's going to be a button called The Rest, R-E-S-T. If you go there, there's going to be some Q&As. Those Q&As will answer questions like, to what extent was William, who replaced Paul, involved in writing and encoding the memoirs of Billy Shears? And the answer is the encoding was done entirely by Thomas E. U. Harriet, even though you, the reader, will realize that much of the material could only have been known by William, the new Paul, or by his closest confidants. And even though William, Bill, is the primary source, we maintain the position that William Paul had nothing to do with it. So they're playing a little bit of this, you know, this fine line, this little game here, because McCartney, the guy who plays McCartney, Bill Shepard, has to be very, very careful as to not to breach his confidentiality agreements and non-disclosure agreements. He's under contract. But another thing that came to mind, Sophia, when I did this work and I looked into this, you and I have talked about straw men, the corporate straw man.
Yep.
So James Paul McCartney is Bill Shepard's straw man. James Paul McCartney, as he's known today, is not a person. He's a corporation, he's a business.
That makes a lot of sense. That's how this whole thing went forward. The only reason I'm nitpicking so much about this cooperation, collaboration is I just want to know the source, because what's happening is we're getting a lot of layering. This is your read of the book.
Right.
The book is Thomas U. Harriot's encoding or whatever compilation of words from this Shepherd guy who now is titled on the book Shears. So you're going to have to explain that too. And so now, you know, I just want to keep things straight so that we know where it's all coming from.
No, fair enough, fair enough. And really, the best way to approach this is for the audience. If you read the book, you'll see, like in the very beginning of the book, Thomas E. U. Harriot says, "The most special thanks to Sir James Paul McCartney for providing such fantastic material." And then a quote from Bill Shepherd, a.k.a. Billy Shears. "Herein is an epic of our hero, Paul McCartney, who entered the underworld and then returned by taking possession of me, an unknown session musician." So it goes on with stuff like that. And what struck me, Sophia, was that the intricacies of the details in the book are so detailed and so voluminous that it would be very, very difficult, almost impossible to believe that anybody but the guy who's playing Paul McCartney wrote the book. Or was at least feeding the information to Thomas E. U. Harriot to write the book.
Right. And what you just said about coming back to take possession, this all sounds really kind of macabre and dark also, right?
Yeah. And to be honest with you, that was one of the, I would say, one of the most unsettling bits of reading this book is that, you know, the Beatles have an image of being this, as far as rock bands go, pretty squeaky clean. Great music. The music was great. Still is to this day. They still have a huge following. The kids are still fans today. But the underpinnings of what the Beatles are about and how the Beatles became successful is dark. And we'll get into that. I'll talk more about that. And that's something I think that's going to be maybe difficult for a lot of people to swallow as we go through this, because there is this image out there of what the Beatles are and what the Beatles are not. I mean, the Stones were always considered the bad boys of rock, and the Beatles were considered the good guys of rock and roll. But what we're going to talk about here is it didn't matter whether you were the Stones or the Beatles, the same underpinnings for both bands and many other bands existed. And those underpinnings were dark. They were ritual based. They were satanic and driven by organizations like Tavistock, British intelligence, and so on. So, and we'll get into more detail on that.
Now, I would use the word origins rather than underpinnings. The origins of the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, were from this much darker place, which in a way kind of echoes that sentiment of having been taken over, because we're all being taken over. We're all under a shroud, and we're all being, you know, draped in this concept of materiality that isn't real at all. And we're being pushed like a, you know, big herd into trends and an artificial society. And that's what this whole Beatles thing was. I mean, as you pointed out to me that the, I do know from a little bit about the Beatles that this Abbey Road album, that was his first appearance as the new Paul, right?
No, Sgt. Pepper was his first. Right. Sgt. Pepper was his first album. Abbey Road was the album when the whole Paul is Dead conspiracy blew up. So it was very interesting because he had been Paul McCartney, playing the part of Paul McCartney for 3 years. And then in 1969, it got legs. And that's when it really got hot and heavy.
So there was a fan base that was suspecting this? Because that Abbey Road cover, you know, there was that whole funeral aspect of it, right?
That was dressed
in the black suit.
Yeah, Sergeant Pepper.
Yeah, but Abbey Road too, wasn't the Abbey Road that
Abbey Road
session?
Yeah, Abbey Road was the one where they're crossing the street. I got it here. Okay. So Abbey Road, the one I'm holding, you're seeing right now. And by the way, folks, I will put this in the slideshow. That's Abbey Road. So Abbey Road was when it really got some legs. And it got legs based upon a DJ, I believe in New York, that started the discussion, and you know, people picked up on it. But before that, it didn't have a lot of momentum. Well, I'll get into that. I'll get into that in a little bit more too, as far as the Beatles and their take on the fact that it didn't get legs. They were absolutely stunned that it wasn't figured out, and it didn't become more of an issue right away, like in 1966, or at the very least 1967, that it took until 1969, essentially 2.5 to 3 years after Bill Shepherd replaced Paul McCartney, that it was even news.
Okay. I was referring to the Undertaker look on the cover of Abbey Road.
Abbey Road, right.
Yeah. So, all right, let's go back to why and how Paul disappeared. He was in a car crash, purportedly. This was 1966, right?
Yeah. He was, before we get there, and I will get there, let me just cover a little bit more about Bill Shepherd so that people get an understanding as we get into this of who he is. Paul McCartney died on September 11th, 1966. And it was very late in the evening. It was pushing near midnight, and he was at the recording studio. He had a little bit of a tiff with Brian Epstein. Many researchers will say that he had an argument with John Lennon. He did not. Lennon wasn't there. It was with Brian Epstein. Epstein was handing out song allocations, if you will, for the next album. So he said, here, Paul, you've got to write 5 songs. John, you've got to write 5 songs. You know, George, you've got your 1 or 2, whatever. So that's the other thing that was kind of interesting in these bands. They were given song quotas for each album. So in any case, McCartney leaves the session, and he's a little agitated. He gets in the car, and as he's driving down the road, he picks up a hitchhiker. This gal by the name of Donna. They're driving, and he misses a light, and there's this horrible accident, and it was very, very bad. He was decapitated, and both bodies were mutilated, and I'll get into more detail on that. So he was replaced by this unknown session musician. His name is William Wallace Shepherd, or Bill Shepherd. He has aliases. His aliases are Billy Shears. So how did he get Shears? It's a play off of Shepherd, Sheep, Shears. Okay, so it's wordplay. They knew him as Billy Shepherd. Vivian Stanshall. We'll talk about Vivian Stanshall a bit. He was with the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band. Sounds kind of crazy, right? It was basically, an act where they did it was like a comedy act. It's almost like vaudeville type of act. And he would dress up in costumes and all this stuff. And you can go on YouTube, you can look up Vivian Stanshall, take a look, and you can see for yourself what he was about. He was also known as Billy Pepper. And so therefore, that's how we wind up with Sergeant Pepper. And I'm going to show you something, Sophia. The audience will get a copy of this in the slideshow. But he used to do these albums called Mercy Mania, or as part of what they referred to back then as the Mercy Beat. And think of the Mercy Beat as the early 1960s, you know, British sound. It was the Beatles, it was the Stones, and a lot of other bands that existed at the time, like Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. There was the Diplomats and so on. And at the very bottom of this CD that I have, it says Mercy Mania, and it says Billy Pepper and the Pepper Pots. This is Bill Shepherd. And if you go inside, well, how do we know it's Bill Shepherd? So if you go inside the case, there's 20 songs. If you take a look at the 20 songs, I'm not sure you can see this very well, but again, I'll put this in the slideshow. You can see of the 20 songs, there was a handful of Beatle covers. So he was already doing Beatle covers. And we're going to get to that too, because this whole thing was engineered and orchestrated. And maybe there's another 10 songs out of the 20, which he penned himself. And you can see it says Bill Shepherd. So, you know, he was writing music, and, you know, he was not famous at the time. So, you know, these types of records were being generated out of these small recording studios in Britain at the time, because they were trying to cash in on the Beatle success. So these bands would put these types of records out. They would do album covers that looked Beatle-ish, and so they were just trying to, you know, to milk the Beatle fame. Now, for some of the folks out there, just bear with me, Sophia, because I've done a lot of research in this over the years, and I know there's a lot of folks that are going to listen to this show, and they're going to ask about Phil Ackrill, okay? Now, Phil Ackrill was a guitar player that played for the Diplomats, and that was a band that Denny Lane played in. And there are many researchers out there that will claim and state that Phil Ackrill was an iteration of Paul McCartney. They will claim that there was a Bill Shepard and there was a Phil Ackrill, at the very least, playing Paul McCartney. Now, I'm going to read something out of this book real quick. I have the page numbers there, so it won't take too long to find it. Now, he's very coy about Phil Ackrill. So he says in the book, "Some Paul is Dead investigators will likely tell you I played then," he's talking about when the Diplomats were playing, back in the early 1960s, "not as the Beatles' Paul McCartney, but as the Diplomats' Phil Ackrill. Everyone ought to consider this question. If I were Phil, why wouldn't I admit it now? He was a dandy singer and a guitar player and a fine person. Who would this Bill rather have been than Phil?" So I think what he's saying there, and again, he's a little bit of wordplay, and I think he's doing it intentionally, but when he says, "Who would this Bill rather have been than Phil?" Well, the answer might be, well, he would rather have been Paul and not Phil. But the problem with that is that at that time, Paul McCartney was alive and well. So being Paul at that point, like 1962, as an example, 61, 62, how could you be Paul? Paul was there. So any case, so for the folks that are listening and they're very adamant about the fact that Phil Ackrill was an iteration or at one point was a Paul McCartney, played that part. It could be, folks, I don't know. But in the book, he doesn't admit it, at least not directly. He's a formally trained musician and can read, write, and score music. This is something that a lot of folks are going to be surprised because it was always been told that the Beatles couldn't read or write music, that, you know, they played by ear and all that stuff. But he is formally trained and he can read, write, and score music. In fact, he mentions in the book that he was involved with some of the scoring of the orchestration on Sgt. Pepper. He is Scottish. He's a direct descendant of William Wallace. This is the character that Mel Gibson played in the movie Braveheart. He is a high-ranking Mason. He admits this in the book and has a very deep understanding of the occult and the esoteric. This comes out very, very clear in the book. Very clear. He's 5 years older than the biological McCartney. He was born in 1937. James Paul McCartney, the biological Paul, was born on June 18, 1942. He claims the biological deceased Paul McCartney works through him from the other side. So there is this possessed, he's channeling him from the other side. Okay, I know it sounds very weird and very bizarre, but we'll talk more about this. This is what's going on here. When I talked about when you said, Sophia, the origins of how the Beatles came about, and we're starting to see now, he's talking about somebody who's died is still plugged into him. He does state in the book why he wrote it, and he said it's because he's getting old. He doesn't have much runway left in his life. In fact, if you do the math, he's pushing 80 years old right now, and he wants to put the truth out there.
Okay, so I have a question.
Yeah.
Because I am not the, you know, music aficionado that a lot of people are who might be listening. I'm just a regular person. So this accident that Paul McCartney had on September 11th, did you say?
Yeah.
Was this an accident, a sort of ill-fated accident by happenstance and naturally it was not contrived, or do you know the answer to that?
I don't know the answer to that definitively. I will tell you that when we get into the dates and we get into Paul McCartney, the biological Paul McCartney's behavior leading up to that date, I will say that it was planned. I'm going to go out on a limb, and there's going to be people that are going to be screaming at me. I believe it was planned, and I believe it was part of a Masonic ritual. And we will get into that. And I think you'll start to see, as I go through more of the details and through more of the numerology, that you can see where it might be easy to come to that conclusion.
Okay, so let's put that in our, you know, back pocket. And so then that makes me wonder if this William Shepard was just lying in wait all those years, the 2.5 years that the real Paul was ambling around being himself.
Yeah.
So this character, descended as he was and I don't know at what time he attained his degree of masonry, but he was from a Masonic lineage. He was pre-selected to become the Uber Beetle, right?
Yes, and I'll explain that. You're absolutely right. That's exactly what happened. He was in the wings. This was not somebody that they stumbled upon and said, oh, you know, I think you'll do. It didn't work that way. He was in the wings. He was there. His role was to take the band, which was a Tavistock project, to take the band to the next level. And I'll get into more detail about what that means.
Now, as a Tavistock project, for the most part, is it safe to say, I'm using that phrase for the most part, did the Beatles start generically and organically as four lads from Liverpool who just happened to be friends and started playing and had their own particular, you know, charm? Did it start out naturally, or were they also put together by this engineering?
I believe the Beatles themselves, and again, this is my surmising, okay? They were very young when they met. Paul McCartney and John Lennon met when they were like 15, 16 years old. So they were teenagers. I do believe that they come from Masonic families, especially the McCartney clan. So I think that it's very possible that biological Paul McCartney was brought along, maybe unbeknownst to him, into this process. But I do believe that the Beatles themselves were organic in the sense that they were four guys at the time when, well, Ringo wasn't there, it was Pete Best. They were four guys and they were, you know, they were playing the bar scene. They were in the Cavern in Liverpool. They're playing in Hamburg, Germany, which was, you know, you couldn't get in a more darker, danker place at that time, you know. So they were paying their dues. I mean, it wasn't like they just got pulled out and said, okay, here you go, suit up and get on the Ed Sullivan Show. I mean, that didn't happen. So they were paying their dues, Sophia, and it was brutal. I mean, when they were in Hamburg, they were living in, you know, four of them in one room, some of them sleeping on the floor and so on. But, you know, I think what happens is that these guys, these bands like the Beatles, the Stones, the Diplomats, Rory Storm and the Hurricanes, and there's a lot of other bands back from those days. I think what happens is they're all doing the same thing. So they become a pool of resource, if you will, in which to pull in. And of course, these are young guys and they're being propositioned with record contracts and money and so on. I mean, and let's face it, what the heck are you doing all that playing for? So that you could just go home exhausted and go work a 9-to-5 job? No, you're going to want to be a rock star. So to answer your question, if I had to take a guess, the four individuals themselves probably had very little, if any, knowledge in the very beginning that they were being engineered and that they were being led and orchestrated.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Doesn't sound like you agree with that.
Now, it's not that I don't agree, it's just that I'm trying to piece together for myself how deep the beginnings of everything really are. I'm listening as we were beginning to record this to an interview that Mark Devlin did of Dave McGowan, and I interviewed Dave McGowan and I read that Laurel Canyon thing when it was online and then the book, and it's very clear that these children of many military officers were shipped to LA to begin the modern folk rock and right. The bands that were popular, and that kind of makes me irritated and annoyed that I was made to like this stuff, in a sense that I didn't just like it because it was a natural part of societal evolution. I liked it because it was stuck in front of my face. My big brother liked it. He liked it for the same reasons, the artificial reasons, you know, because it was all we had. It's the same reason that you drive along today and you come to a red light and there's some teenager in the car listening to the most dissonant stuff. And I'm thinking, why are they listening to this? But this is their music, just the way that was our music, right? Right. But right. Somebody gave all this music to us. Somebody handed it to us. It was on plates. It was on the smorgasbord, the buffet. And that's what we chose, and that's what we listened to. And that makes me annoyed. I can't explain why.
No, I completely can relate to that, because as I was reading through the book, Sophia, I was getting angry. I was getting angry because, you know, because we're friends, you know that I am a big Beatle freak, and they are the reason why I picked up the guitar, and they're the reason that I learned to write music, record music, and so on. Now, I wasn't naive. I mean, I didn't think that they just, you know, hip-hopped along and, you know, they just basically got lucky and they had all this fame and fortune. I mean, I had the wherewithal to know that you had to have it networked, you had to be plugged in, and there were favors. But at the end of the day, you're still thinking that the band itself was still four individuals that were organic, creative, you know, doing their thing. But after I got done reading this book, it was upsetting. It was upsetting because the realization came over me like a wave, like I was standing on the beach and it's like 50-foot wave smashed me to the ground. I had to come to grips with the fact that, Mike, what you thought they were about, or what any band was about, is not true. That it's another deception. It's another falsehood. It's another lie. So I completely get it. I completely get it. And I'm not trying to put a happy face on with this, because this was hard for me to swallow. As we said in the beginning of the show, I didn't really want to get into this. I really didn't want to believe this, but, you know, doing the work that I do and doing the research, I'm like, well, you just can't sit there and say you're not going to look at it. So I did, with an open mind. And when I came out of it, Paul McCartney died on September 11th, 1966. And we've been listening to Bill Shepard for 50 years. That's the net of it, folks. I mean, does it make you feel good? And I'll tell you, as I get more into this, there's a lot of other stuff that you're not going to like.
All right. Well, you keep saying, as I get more into this, I'm going to tell more later. This is going to be quite a long haul, but we'll do it. I don't care how many hours this interview takes. So listen, from your notes that you sent me, I see that Paul McCartney was having recurring dreams, nightmares, in which he was dying, or in which he died. So what was that all about? Why was he having these dreams? And then he became obsessed with the dreams.
Yeah, that's right. So Paul was having these dreams, and they were nightmares, and they were premonitions, and they were predicting his death. That by itself, when you first read the book, he gets into that early on in the book, Bill Shepard does. When I first started to read it, I'm like, okay, so he's having death dreams. Okay, where's this book going, you know? But I wasn't that far into the book, so I kept reading. He had become obsessed with the dreams, as you had mentioned. It was preoccupying him. He would talk to the other band members about it. He would talk to Lennon and to George Harrison and Ringo Starr about it, but they didn't take it seriously. In fact, in the book, Shepard mentions that, you know, they would kind of play with him and, you know, kind of rib him a little bit about it. But, you know, they didn't think that it was going to mean anything. But the interesting thing is, in the book, Shepard is saying that, you know, as McCartney's having these nightmares, he's planning his departure and his replacement. That, you know, he's getting things in order. He understands that he doesn't have long to live. Now, he's a healthy kid. He's about, what, you know, 19. The biological Paul was born in 42. So we're talking about 1965 as an example. So what is he, 23 years old? He's a healthy 23-year-old kid, and he's having these nightmares, and he's predicting his death, and he's making plans.
I'm going to interrupt again and say this. So now you're speaking through the perceptions of the real Paul, right? Because you're saying he's telling us that he's having these dreams, blah, blah, blah. So this isn't the fake Paul. This is the real one. And how does this, you, Harriet, get into the head of the real Paul? It's through Billy Shepard.
Through Bill Shepard.
Other band members told me. So it's being passed along through that other layer temporarily, right?
Right. So in other words, the way it would happen is John Lennon was talking to Bill Shepard, or George Harrison to Bill Shepard, and saying this is what was going on leading up to his death on September 11th, 1966, that he was having these nightmares.
Okay. That's fine. I just want to again know, where is everything coming from that I'm learning? So that's why I need to clarify it.
Okay. So everything is coming from Bill Shepard, and Bill Shepard is, he gets his information from, think of it as basically two sources. One, his own personal experience, which is most of the book. And then for stuff where he wasn't there, he's getting that information from having spent all that time with the remaining band members and other people. I mean, he was very tied into, he's a very high-ranking Mason, and we'll get into, in my view, so was Brian Epstein, George Martin, for sure, who was their producer. So I'm going to, again, put this out there. It's not in the book, but I got the feeling that there was table setting Sofia before he actually even got there, and perhaps there were things that he knew before he got there. And then, you know, he was able to solidify those things by having discussions with the remaining Beatles once Paul McCartney died. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Now, okay, so when you keep saying that he was this one was a high-ranking Mason and that one was, this is sort of a side question. Do you get to be a high-ranking Mason quickly, or are you an initiate that then travels to the higher rankings of Masonry because of what you do and what you perform for them? So eventually these guys got to be high-ranking Masons rather than they started at 21 and they were in the high degree of Masonry.
He was a Mason at the time when he entered into the picture, because he clearly states that. The way he phrases it is that his uncle at the time was a much higher ranking Mason than he was. And his uncle, he doesn't mention who he is, his uncle was absolutely instrumental in throwing the switch and making it happen. Okay, so that's, so he makes that statement in the book. And he said, yeah, I'm trying to remember the quote because I don't have the actual page in front of me now. I believe what he said was, my uncle was a much higher ranking Mason than I was at that time. And so what I read into that comment in the book is that today he's equal to or at a higher degree than his uncle. And I would think that his uncle had to be at least a 33rd degree Mason because of how it transpired. And I'll take you through that. Your eyeballs will pop out of your head, I'm telling you.
Mm-hmm. So we have this McCartney family, Paul's family, that was also Masonic, right? And this new shepherd guy, he's from a Masonic family. He's got some uncle that's a very high-ranking Mason, and the McCartney family is Masonic. So,
well, I'm making a guess, an educated guess, that the McCartney family were Masons because of the way this went down.
Okay, and that's fair, because you've done an awful lot of inquiry into this material yourself, this general landscape of Masonry. So this whole thing, this replacement, the organic Paul's fear of death, and then the replacement with this Uber guy, this was, for what purpose do you think? Because Paul would never have been the force that could have gotten the Beatles to this very high prominence. What do you, can you say anything about that?
Yeah. So what it was a shift in gears, right? So the biological Paul took them from 1963 to 1966. That was a certain era, if you will, of the Beatles, a certain era of music. And then they were going to make the change from the boy band love songs to the psychedelic era. And so when they brought Bill Shepherd in, or Bill Shepherd was placed into the band, they brought in somebody who was highly, highly qualified, somebody who was extremely talented, and he was going to take him to that next level. And it's very interesting. Let me show you something here. Again, folks, I will put this into the show notes, but this is a very important, I think, piece of the puzzle here. Now, this is a Beatle album. You see this, Sophia. I don't want to block the microphone so the folks can hear me. It's called A Collection of Beatle Oldies. Now, I always found this record to be very, very odd, because this record is called, A Collection of Beatles Oldies, and it covers the band's music from 1963 when they debuted with Please Please Me to 1966. That's the biological Paul era, 1963 to 1966. And they're calling it A Collection of Beatles Oldies. Why would it be oldies? Why would a song from 1963 or 64 be old in 1966? So what they're doing here is they're saying, ladies and gentlemen, this is the old band. They didn't call it the greatest hits. That would have been different. If they would have said the Beatles greatest hits to this point, nobody would have blinked. But they're calling it oldies. And on the Billy Shears website, they say that the person on the front cover, and again, folks, I will put this in the show notes so you can see what I'm talking about here. This man on the front cover of this album cover, which I always thought was odd too, because there's nothing Beatles about it. That's Bill Shepard. Okay, so they're depicting Bill Shepard on the front cover. And over here, you can see the car. This is the car McCartney was in going down that road. So there's a lot of symbolism in this record. So they took that album and basically made that the part one of the Beatles. Part two is the Bill Shepard era.
Do you see that purple jacket too? You know that purple is the sign of death.
Yeah.
The color of death. Just thought I'd throw that in so I don't appear to be totally ignorant.
No, you're doing great. Look, I told you before this show, there was so much here, Sophia, that I'm hoping that I can make some sense out of it, to be honest with you. So there you go. I mean, so they had that album come out and marking the farewell, if you will, to the first part of the Beatle history.
Okay, so let's cover his ability to step into Paul's shoes, which wasn't literal because he had bigger feet. He was taller and he had bigger feet, and apparently the fans didn't seem to notice. But these surgeries he had, also the eyes, because the McCartney eyes and the Shepherd eyes seem to be very close. They're not that divergent in terms of shape. They're kind of unique, both of them, to me anyway, yeah. And similar, right?
Yeah. So how was it done? You want me to take you through that?
Yeah.
Okay, so how was it done? First and foremost, it's very important that the audience understand, and this is what Bill Shepard explains throughout the book. So this is not me, this is not my thoughts, this is not me surmising. This is what he says in the book, that he and Paul are spiritually connected, that they are channeling, or he's able to channel Paul McCartney, that he's influenced by the Paul, the biological Paul that has passed. It's referred to as Paulism, and Paulism is based in Satanism. Okay, I know a lot of people right now probably just fell out of their chairs, but he explains this in the book. Okay, he utilizes mysticism and his understanding of his esoteric teachings from being a Freemason. He recalls in the book a seance where he channeled Paul McCartney's voice, and the rest of the Beatles were there. So you have this whole occult thing going on, okay? And it's big time occult stuff, big time. You're not just dabbling in it. This guy, Bill Shepard, is big time into Freemasonry, big time into the esoteric, big time into the occult and understandings of the occult.
So is it fair to say that in the takeover of the Beatles by this Bill Shepard, this was assisted by real dark forces.
Yes. Yeah, we would consider it dark. He doesn't, by the way. This is very interesting. And like I said, I'll talk about that a little bit. Man, it's really interesting the way he parses it, Sophia. It's very interesting.
So what does that then say about or cast on the absolutely massive fan base of the Beatles? What does that say? That this fan base, in having been taken in by this transition, assisted by what you and I would call darkness, they might not call it that, but we're calling it that. So then the fan base had also been affected directly by darkness. That's what I would say.
Yes, I mean, it had to be, right? You and I have had this discussion before where they're able to manipulate consciousness. Well, this is a direct manipulation of consciousness and thought. And again, like I mentioned earlier, they were a Tavistock project, flat out. There's no question. He talks about it in the book. Okay, so they're doing social engineering. They're doing manipulation of the consciousness, manipulation of the mind. There's all these things that are in play. The whole psychedelic era. They were connected into Timothy Leary, Kenneth Anger, who was the successor to Aleister Crowley. I mean, there's all this stuff that's embedded in this thing.
Well, it's making me rethink a lot now. And this to me is a new page that just has been turned for me anyway. So the employment of, let's just call it, greater dimensionality in this Beatles transition and the public tidal wave that it created, This was actually, you said other bands knew about this replacement, Donovan, The Who, Elton John, right?
Yes, they all knew about it. That's the other thing. So that answers the question as to, well, you know, did these other band members know? And the answer is, yes, they did. And they went absolutely nowhere with it because they were all part and parcel of the package. They were all into the same thing, all of them.
Yeah, that would have to be the case. And they probably appreciated the kind of power that made this transition work. And I'm not talking just about, you know, enough money and enough influence that you could have basically a walk-in. You would have a walk-in on many levels appear and start to engage in the world of modern music. This was, you know, the term walk-in, right?
Yes. Yep. That's exactly right. So Donovan, you know, he knew it. He had many, many discussions with Bill Shepherd when Shepherd first showed up, as did the Stones, especially Mick Jagger, The Who. In fact, the Donovan, the Stones, The Who, and Elton John all wrote Paul is Dead songs. They all wrote songs that had to do with Paul being dead. I didn't know this. And in the book, he breaks it down. He breaks down some of those songs. He breaks down the lyrics and he explains, you know, how to interpret the songs. He and Denny Lane, as an example, for folks who know and follow Bill Shepherd's solo career as the character Paul McCartney, you know, when he had Wings, he was with Denny Lane. Well, he and Denny Lane, Bill Shepherd and Denny Lane go way back, way back. That's why Denny Lane was there when he went solo, because they were buds. Going back to when Denny Lane was playing with the Diplomats. So all of these guys are very close, Sophia. They're all tied in. They were all doing very similar gigs. They all knew each other. And, you know, a lot of these bands were, you know, at a point where they were receiving tremendous fame and fortune. And so, in the book, he states the Stones are flat out Satanists. He just states that in the book.
But he doesn't think that's bad, right?
He walks a line on that. You know, let me just see if I can get to something here real quick and I'll explain it.
In the meantime, let me just say that I'm sorry to have imbued this with a good, bad kind of schism. I didn't really mean to do that in the sense that in this dimensionality play, as you said, these forces they vie for control. They compete and vie for control. And this whole idea of the name being Shepherd,
yeah,
this to me suggests that he was a shepherd for a dimensionality influence in modern culture.
Yep. And there's no doubt that his name is symbolic of what he was asked to do. Yeah, let me cover this real quick with regard to the question about Satanism being good or bad. And like I said, he parses it. Okay. So this is, I was kind of shaking my head when I was going through this and putting it together. In the book, he openly discusses the occult. He openly discusses Satanism. He talks about Freemasonry, mysticism, and all that stuff. Talks about Aleister Crowley, Kenneth Anger, esoteric symbolism, and as I mentioned, Satanism. And on one hand, he's talking about all that stuff and how that stuff was a contributor, a gigantic, tremendous contributor to the success of the Beatles and other bands. But then he goes about and he disavows Crowley and says that was a doctrine of hate and says he's not a Satanist. He explains that he leveraged Satanism to achieve success. He's not a Satanist, but he leveraged Satanism to achieve success. Now, those are my words, but essentially going through the book and pulling out of it what was his position, that was his position. I'm not a Satanist, but I use Satanism in order to be successful. Now, I don't know. That didn't sit well with me, I have to be honest with you.
So this is Shepherd saying that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Shepherd saying that. And, you know, he's deeply into numerology. He has one chapter in the book where he's just going through numbers and how he likes to play with numbers. But then he states he's not caught up in it. In the book, he states several times that McCartney, the biological Paul, is all about the nines. And he's all about the sixes and how he likes to play with numbers. And he loves to play with anagrams. But, you know, he's not really into the numbers. The 666s and the 999s don't mean a whole lot to him. But then on the other hand, when you take a look at Sgt. Pepper, the entire Sgt. Pepper album is replete with enormous levels of esoteric symbolism. So it's like, it's kind of like he wants to have his cake and eat it too. That's kind of how I, you know, what I got out of it. But, you know, when you take all that stuff and just separate it, it's what you had said. There is the occult. There is the tapping into unseen forces in order to bring about that success. And that's what they were doing.
Well, yeah, I mean, to me, that's very interesting because, you know, we assume that there is this backdrop of darkness, Satanism, Luciferianism, occultism, in everything that is deployed at us as whatever, the formation of culture, lives, history. But actually to think that it's not just a backdrop, it's an active force, and it works as an active force, you know. Now, this example that you've given makes me rethink a lot, as I just said. It makes me wonder, okay, so they're actually able to use their darkness. They're able to configure it so that it affects us whether we know it or not.
Right.
That's kind of what is powerful here for me.
Well, the other thing that what made me understand is that, you know, we tend to think in terms of the of the occult being a something that is in the music industry, let's say over the last 20 years or so, where it became more prevalent, it's more in our face. And it is more in our face because of videos and all that stuff. But it made me understand that, hey, Mike, it's not something that was just, you know, the last 20 years. We're going back 50 years. And like you said, it's a driving force. This is not just like a little assist, a little aid to help you become successful. This is the actual, you know, this is the engine to drive the success.
Yeah, that's something to contemplate, really. It makes you want to rethink everything. It makes you want to rethink, you know, Apple computers and everything that's happening.
Yeah.
Everything that's happening. But anyway, so let's persist in this hunt. Do you naturally know where you want to go next?
Well, I think what we should do, did you want me to finish up on some of the occult and the Masonic stuff? You think maybe we should do that?
No, it's too scary. Let's depart for a minute.
Okay, let's go to the key dates then. You want to do that?
Yeah.
When things transpired? Okay. All right, so as I mentioned before, McCartney dies in a very brutal car crash the evening of Sunday, September 11th, 1966. He's decapitated. There was a lady passenger. She was hitchhiking. He picked her up on the way on the road. Her name was Donna. We don't get a last name, but her name was Donna. The bodies were pronounced dead after midnight on Monday, September 12th, 1966. At this time, they don't know the identities of the bodies. That's why I said the bodies were pronounced dead. This is where it gets really interesting. Brian Epstein meets Bill Shepard on September 12th, the day after the car crash, and brings him on board. And as I mentioned before, that Shepard was known as Billy Pepper and was recording Mercy Beat albums, which included Beatle cover songs. And it was those albums were by Billy Pepper and the Pepper Pots, and Billy Pepper is Bill Shepard. Epstein sends John Lennon a telegram because Lennon was not in the UK at the time. He was in Paris. And he sends that telegram to Lennon on Tuesday, September 13th, 1966. He does not specifically say that Paul passed away. He said something to the effect that dreams do come true, which, you know, is not the way I probably would have worded it. So it's very bizarre. You know, it's like this whole like dynamic is getting kind of creepy. Donna's parents were notified on Wednesday, September 14th, 1966, that her daughter was killed in the car crash. And they had found a passport. And so they were able to identify her that way. But you know, of course, it took time to identify the bodies, especially McCartney's, due to the mutilation, the level of the body not being together. Epstein introduced Bill Shepard to John Lennon on Friday, September 16th, 1966, 5 days after Paul died, and this was done in Paris, France. That's where Lennon was. Lennon was incredibly distraught. when Shepard went to meet Lennon, because they had to talk, because John was the leader of the Beatles at the time, Shepard had put together a list of demands, because his take on it was, look, if I'm going to do this, it has to be worth my while. My whole life's going to change. I'm not going to be Bill Shepard anymore. I have to play this guy called Paul McCartney. I'm going to look different. I'm not going to be able to be with people I used to be with. My whole life is going to change. So I'm going to go for the gusto. And the top demand was that he takes control of the Beatles. And he put that proposition out there. And the way he tells the story is that, you know, Lennon was under extreme duress. And he just said, fine. He agreed to relinquish control of the Beatles. And he handed the baton over to Bill Shepard, who, for the sake of Sergeant Pepper, was Billy Shears. And he becomes the new leader of the Beatles. And the other demand that he made was that the Beatles were no longer going to be doing love songs, that era was over. Because that's predominantly what they were doing up through 1966. Girl loves boy, boy loves girl songs, love, and so on. He says they're going to take the band in a different direction. And then, therefore, Sgt. Pepper became Shepard's debut album. Sgt. Pepper is Bill Shepard's album. The other Beatles, as band members, of course, participated. Lennon wrote some brilliant songs. He wrote Lucy in the Sky, A Day in the Life. But make no mistake about it, the Sgt. Pepper album was Bill Shepard's album. Now, there is also some word out there, you know, in the Beatle research, Paul is Dead research community, that the song Sgt. Pepper and Fixing a Hole, which is another song on Sgt. Pepper, was supposedly written by Shepard and Beatle manager Malcolm Mal Evans. He was known as Mal Evans, who was supposed to be their road manager, but he really was a handler. In fact, I have a recording of a show that took place in the early 1970s where Mal Evans admits that he wrote Sgt. Pepper and Fixing a Hole with Bill Shepard. Doesn't call him Bill Shepard though, calls him Paul. So anyway, so those were the two biggie demands that he made, Sophia. I now control the Beatles and we're not doing love songs anymore. We're taking this to another level.
Well, that makes one think that Paul's death was definitely on the table and there was a real intent to take this Beatle phenomenon into a particular direction.
Yes. So let me cover that a little bit, and I think I'll shine some light on that, and I think folks will agree that you're absolutely correct. In the book, he states that his uncle, I mentioned this before, was a very high-ranking Mason, and he called George Martin, his uncle called George Martin, on September 12, 1966, after finding out that McCartney had died. Now, this becomes peculiar because, according to other parts of the book, Shepard is saying they're still trying to identify the body on September 12th. But on September 12th, his uncle calls George Martin, who was the Beatles producer, and says, and ordered him. In the book, it says his uncle ordered George Martin, not didn't ask him, didn't request it, ordered him to have Shepard replace McCartney. And he said that he was selected, that Bill Shepard was selected because of his long qualifying lineage and musical talent. And the same uncle ordered Shepard to acquire the talent in anticipation of that day. That's an exact quote out of the book. His uncle ordered Shepard to acquire the talent that he had in anticipation of that day. Now, does that sound like it was planned? It sounds like it was planned to me.
Oh, yeah. It does. Yup. Sadder and sadder this gets.
So when George Martin caught up with Brian Epstein, Epstein had already stated to Martin that Shepard had already been selected. That's how quickly this whole thing went down. So George Martin gets ordered to take Shepard on board. George Martin goes to call Brian Epstein. Brian Epstein already had selected Shepard as a replacement for the biological Paul McCartney. Unbelievable.
Yep.
And again, folks, I know this sounds amazing. It might even sound unbelievable. But this is what's in the book. Okay. Where I have to kind of connect the dots, I will tell you. But unless I say that, it's in the book.
Okay, so, you know, you did send me your notes, and I'm looking at something here, that the other Beatles did not have Shepherd's productive, you know, bent.
His work ethic.
Yeah, you said work ethic, but they did not appear to share this we must do kind of inclination, and they had a difficult time with him.
Yeah. So the relationship he had with the other Beatles was up and down. So in the book, he mentions that John Lennon in particular could be very harsh and difficult at times with him. You know, John was kind of lashing out. Lennon did obviously miss his boyhood buddy, Paul McCartney. And now he's got this other guy in a studio and he's got to work with him and make believe that, you know, everything has is the same and nothing has changed. Where, you know, where in reality, your best friend is dead and I've got a replacement and I got to play along with this thing, right? So he does say in the book, though, that there were many moments as time went on when they got along just fine. And where John would even say to him, you know, Bill, you know, I love you. But then there were other times when it became very difficult. And he says that it was very hard for him because, you know, they didn't take to him. And especially when it came down to recording and doing the work. He states in the book that he has a tremendous work ethic. He is a perfectionist, and the other Beatles were not. He says they were talented guys, talented musicians. They were very used to going into the studio with their songs, banging them out, and then, you know, unplugging the guitar, walking out, and letting the engineers and the producer do the rest of the work on the songs. And that was not him. That he was not only the musician, but he was the engineer and the producer, if you will. So he had put in very, very long hours when he did Sgt. Pepper. If I recall from the book, he would be walking out of Abbey Road Studios at 2 a.m. in the morning. Now, the other thing, and you have to excuse my language on this, but I mean, the other thing that was a big piss off to the other guys was that he had mentioned in the book that he would redo tracks. Now, I could tell you as a musician, if I go in and I record a track and everybody's like, yeah, that's good. Yeah, that does it. It's good. We're done. And then I come in the next day and I find out that my track was erased and it was done over by Bill Shepherd. That's going to put a little bit of a sour taste in your mouth. And he admits to doing that.
Okay. And, so, yeah. Like, the alternative for the surviving Beatles, let's just call that, the remaining Beatles, would have been not to be the Beatles anymore. So they agreed to this replacement because it gave them somewhere to go. Or now I'm thinking they didn't have an alternative because it comes down from the highest levels of masonry, right?
I don't think they had a choice. I don't think they had a choice. I think that the Beatles were such a huge, first of all, they were huge money for the British government. That's number one. We know that they are a Tavistock project. We know that they were completely tied into British intelligence. You know, I'm talking about the Beatles as an entity. I'm not talking about John Lennon or George Harrison or Ringo Starr personally. So, I mean, the stakes in the game were tremendous. And, you know, he doesn't say it in the book, but I have to assume, Sophia, that they had to be sat down. And you remember, these guys are, in 1967, they were like 24, 25 years old. So they had to sit these 24, 25-year-old guys down and say, okay, look, this is the way this is going to work. Okay? You're gonna do this, whether you like it or not. Okay? And you're going to keep your mouth shut. And you're going to make believe that nothing happened. And see that guy over there? He's Paul McCartney now. Keep going. I don't think, to be honest with you, going through everything we're going through here, like you said, that there was really any options other than you have to stay in the band and continue to chug along. And when we talk about the breakup of the Beatles in 1970, that was not Yoko Ono. It was Bill Shepherd. Bill Shepherd broke the Beatles up. He admits it in the book. He broke the Beatles up because it had gotten to the point where it was too stressful. There was too much conflict. He decided that's it. Throwing the towel in, I'm out. So Bill Shepherd was in control from the beginning until the end.
Well, that just would have created a very deep unhappiness in those three other guys, which kind of, to me, that seems to be completely the way of entertainment. These people that everyone else looks to as the luckiest, most beautiful, richest, most, you know, enviable people, envied people in the world, they are profoundly, profoundly unhappy because of how much they are always controlled. And this is another, this is a very enormous example of that.
Yeah. Yeah. And remember, everybody has to remember, these were young guys. Think about a 24 or 25-year-old guy sitting there with his guitar. He's achieved tremendous fame and fortune, money, notoriety, celebrity. So I guess it was like, okay.
Now, why did you say they were a source of such revenue for the British government, may I ask?
Because Beatle record sales, the exports, the Beatles record sales were huge. That's not in the book. That's in another book that I read. In fact, I think I read it in Nick Kallerstrom's book. But let's just, I guess we could suffice to say that there was tremendous amount of money that was invested into the Beatles and that the Beatles were creating tremendous amounts of money for whomever.
They were a cash cow. They were a phenomenon that was laying the way for all kinds of other, you know, explosions in the music world. So, yes. And to say nothing of the fashion world with the long hair and the bell bottoms and the
Beetle
psychedelic
boots.
Art and posters. Yeah. And I mean, this was going to shape the next leg of human life, really.
Exactly. Guitars, amplifiers, everything. They catapulted an entire generation into an area that it didn't exist before. I mean, people weren't, I mean, we didn't have bands going out there, throngs of them because of Bill Haley and the Comets. You know, when the Beatles hit the scene, I mean, it really lit it on fire. Did you want to talk a little bit more about how it was done?
Well, we didn't cover the plastic surgery enough. I'm still curious about the eyes.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Because I think a lot of people say that it couldn't have been done because there's too many bases that had to be covered. And the truth of the matter is that I believe that there was a huge win for Tavistock in this whole thing, if nothing else, and they got a lot out of it. But they realized, Sophia, that people see what they want to see. And we could talk more about that if you want me to explain it some more.
Yes, of course. People see what they want to see.
Right.
Let me rephrase that. People see what you show them.
People see what you show them, but also people see what they want to see. It's more people see what they want to see. And he mentions this in the book. So remember I said before that the switch was made in 1966. He was undergoing extensive plastic surgery. He talks about fillers. There was a lot of work that was done on Bill Shepard to morph him into somebody who looked more and more like Paul McCartney over time. But one of the key things that they figured out was that he was able to assimilate and blend by association. We mentioned before that, you know, he had different physical attributes. He was taller. He has a narrower face. He has different ears. He has bigger feet. But the thing was, he was pictured with the Beatles as Paul McCartney. So therefore, he is Paul McCartney. And people looked right past all of the obvious. That's Paul McCartney. Well, doesn't he look different? Oh, yeah, you know, different era. It's psychedelic. They grew their hair out, different clothing, mustaches and beards. But that's Paul McCartney. And I think that this was such a tremendous revelation to the people that were involved in the engineering, like Tavistock and British intelligence. Because all along, they were very concerned that people were going to figure it out. And then what was going to happen? What was going to happen when people figured out we duped them? But nobody figured it out. Or at
Let
least,
me ask you this.
Yeah.
I have a couple of questions here now. So I was friendly with a display designer once. She did department store windows. And she told me that you can sell anything if you display it correctly, if you display it effectively.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what it is, but you can sell it if you know how to display it. So I would say they did that with Paul McCartney, Bill Shepard. But you, Mike, in the time that you did not accept the replacement story, what did you say about the comparison of faces and bodies?
Sophia, I look back at it now and I feel kind of dumb, to be honest with you. But I'll tell you what my thinking was. I think a big piece of it was that I just didn't want to believe it. Not that I didn't want to believe it, I just didn't think that a conspiracy this huge, where somebody is in the public eye all the time, was possible. I would think that I would always think to myself, somebody's going to step forward. There are other bands, there are people that he knows, there are people that he works with, and you're going to tell me that nobody has stepped forward and said, that guy is not Paul McCartney? That's what I was thinking. And myself, like many others, got duped into the whole change in scenery. So if you take a look back at the old Beatle albums, like Beatles for Sale or Meet the Beatles, and you take a look at how they were dressed in those little gray suits and everything else with the mop top haircuts, and then all of a sudden, Sergeant Pepper comes out, completely different. It's a different band. They have the colorful band outfits on, and they got these mustaches and these beards, and all of a sudden this boy band became something so much different. Like they grew up. The Beatles grew up. Look at them now. And I think that that's what happened. Look, I can even kick myself because as I go back now and I listen to, let's say, a song like Yesterday, which is biological Paul, or Eleanor Rigby, which is biological Paul. And then I listen to Penny Lane, or I listen to Hello Goodbye. That's clearly not the same guy singing. It sounds a little similar, but it's clearly not the same guy. And so why didn't I pick that up? And I didn't pick it up because I was more focused on the music. I was focused, the music was great. No matter how you shake it, regardless of how people leave listening to this, they feel about what Bill Shepard did. The bottom line is the man is a brilliant musician. He wrote brilliant songs, and he still does to this day. And I guess I was caught up in all of that as a musician myself, and just being an aficionado of music. So
So you were dazzled by the effect, really.
I was dazzled by the effect. Yeah, I would say so.
So their display was extremely successful. So let me throw this into the mix. Is it possible in this, let's just go into the dimensionality, the incorporation of extra dimensionality, that, or even mind control, if that's what you want to call it, that the success of the walk-in was due to, in part, the extra dimensional influence and or mind control of Bill Shepherd, such that he was infused with the idea that he was Paul now, and that his job was to play Paul. So can you talk about both of those, separate them, and then talk about them together?
Okay, so he obviously, when we look at this whole thing, he was a ringer. Okay, now they had a moment in time when they did this, when it was very shaky, and it's when it first happened. But once they got over that hurdle, once they realized that he was being viewed as Paul McCartney, that people weren't, there were people that were picking up on it, obviously, and they were asking questions, but the vast majority of the population, they were oblivious. That was Paul McCartney. Once they got past that little hump, I think that they thought to themselves, we have smooth sailing. And for the most part, he did. I'll mention a couple of situations where it was not, where there were some close calls. So I think that that was one aspect of it. They put somebody in there that once they got over that hump, that initial shaky point, they knew that this guy, he had the talent, the skills, and the abilities to carry it forward. Now, his ability to do that, and this is very important, and this is a very important piece of the book, as you had mentioned, it was his ability to be influenced and to be channeling and to be completely connected to Paul McCartney on the other side. There was a possession. Bill is Paul, Paul is Bill. So he views that to this day, because this book was finished in 2009. So as of 7 years ago, I'm sure that he hasn't changed his mind that these guys are essentially sharing the same physical body. Obviously, he believes that that connection is a huge piece in his ability to be able to take on the whole Paul persona and to be Paul McCartney. And as he's playing the character of Paul McCartney, to think like Paul McCartney, to act like Paul McCartney.
There had to be a certain amount of willingness and enthusiasm on his part to do this, to get into it on that level, to say, yes, I want my body shared with this presence of this person who has departed. I want to achieve all this. I'm going to do everything in my power and in my being to make it happen. So there had to be some very deep level of cooperation and participation and desire in him, right?
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. In fact, he mentions in the book that, you know, he had very lucid dreams where Paul McCartney was in those dreams. In fact, this is going to sound very, very strange to people, but, you know, he had, when he had met John Lennon in France, and Lennon, you know, relinquished control of the Beatles to him, one of the things that Lennon had said to him was, well, okay, so you play left-handed. He goes, no, I play right-handed, but don't worry about it. I'll play left-handed. And you know, I guess Lennon looked at him like, okay. And so the way he was able to play left-handed, this is what he explains in the book, is that he was trying to teach himself to play left-handed, guitar and bass. And I guess he was working on the bass initially. And he played the Beatles' Revolver album. That was the last album that Biological Paul played on. That was the album before Sgt. Pepper. And he wasn't getting it. He was not able to play left-handed. And so he summoned Paul McCartney and asked for help. And I'm going to paraphrase this, but it's going to be a very accurate paraphrasing. He, you know, once he did that, he sensed and felt McCartney's presence come to him and come over him. And once that happened, he played bass left-handed. Now, some people are going to shake their heads and they're going to say, that sounds like a bunch of nonsense, but the guy's playing left-handed. Something happened where this right-handed guitar player all of a sudden was very good at playing left-handed.
You know who wouldn't believe this part of this interview or this part of your analysis? Fetzer. The fact that an interdimensional assistance was given is what would be hard for him to believe.
Got it. No, you're absolutely right. There's a lot of people, if you don't understand that or you don't believe that that stuff exists, you will never accept that premise. You will never. Now, my response to people who would debate that, let's say if Jim were talking to me, I would say, Jim, I'm a guitar player. I've been playing guitar since I was 15 years old. Okay, I'm 57 today, so I've been playing guitar for a long time. If tomorrow you said to me, Mike, we want you to be in this band, you're going to make a lot of money. But here's the catch. You've got to play guitar left-handed. I'd be like, you know what, guys? That's not going to happen. In fact, after I read this book, what I did, Sophia, I went down to Sam Ash, big music store here throughout the country. And I picked up a lefty guitar. I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to plug it in because I don't want to sound like, you know, I'm completely inept at this. But I said, let me see how good I can do with this thing. Just picking it up and playing. It was a mess, a total mess. And I know how the chords are played. I know how the fingers, you know, where they go on the fretboard. I know all of this stuff. I've been playing guitar for 40 something years. Right-handed, I'm a pretty good guitar player. Left-handed, forget it. It was like a three-year-old. So somehow this right-handed guitar player became extremely competent playing left-handed. So if you don't believe it was because he's into the occult and he's channeling unseen forces, then you're going to have to come up with another explanation. I don't know what that would be. And by the way, he states that when he records, he still plays right-handed because playing right-handed is still feels natural to him. You know, he's gotten to be very good playing left-handed, but when he goes into the recording studio, he plays right-handed. So what does that tell you? That tells you that if he's sitting in the recording studio, unless he's sitting there by himself recording, there's going to be other people there. There's going to be engineers, there's going to be producers, and maybe other band members. He's playing right-handed. They know. They know it's not Paul McCartney. They know it's Bill Shepard sitting in that room.
Yeah. In fact, when you said you felt like a three-year-old, I think now of doing the same thing with writing. This is an aside, but it's interesting, so I'll throw it in. In therapy, psychotherapy, When you're in a quandary about something, you don't know what to do in a certain situation, it's suggested that you write down your feelings with your non-dominant hand. And the result is this very spidery, childlike, you know, paragraph or two. And you absolutely have to be economical. You cannot go on and on and on. You have to parse out from your thinking exactly what it is that gets put down on the paper, because you don't have a lot of muscle power or control or ability in that hand. You want to make it as short as possible. And the result, Mike, it often makes you want to cry, because you see this very, very puerile, real self coming out in this childlike handwriting. So it's a regressive tactic or technique, but they use the non-dominant hand for that.
And by the way, he thought he was in big, big trouble. At that point, up until the point where he was able to get some, you know, some help from the other side, he thought it was over. He thought that he had to throw the towel in and it was just not going to work. And he states that in the book.
Very interesting. So that's really a big piece of it then, a big piece. So let's move on. Find us the next natural piece of the puzzle.
Well, I think what we should do is maybe we should cover close calls, because he did have situations that cropped up over time where he got really close to being outed. So did you want me to take you through that?
Yes.
Okay. So back in 1966, there was a reporter by the name of Samuel, Sam. He knew of the car crash and he knew it was Paul McCartney's car. And he had confronted Brian Epstein. And he was very persistent, this reporter, and he was some UK newspaper. I'm not sure he mentions it in the book. Epstein kept trying to give him, you know, some story that, no, it's not his car. You know, the Beatles just got back from touring and being on the road, and, you know, Paul's at home relaxing and everything else. And this reporter kept pushing and saying, that's his car. I'm not going anywhere until you come clean with me. And if you don't tell me what's going on here, I'm going to put this in the paper. And this was on, a Tuesday, because he said he was going to run the article, I think, on Wednesday. And so what happened was Epstein threatened him with a libel lawsuit and said, look, if you publish that, okay, you're going to be in court for years. At the end of the day, what happened was Epstein paid him off and sent him on a little cruise. And he is referenced in Paul McCartney's song, or Bill Shepard's song, Band on the Run, when he talks about Sailor Sam. Sailor Sam, because the sailor went on a cruise, right? Sam the reporter. So that's a little nod and a wink. I should say wink and a nod with regard to that situation. So they paid him off. And he does say in the book that they didn't have to pay a lot of people off, but there were people that they had to give money to go away and to be quiet. He doesn't say who those people are. He said it wasn't a lot, but he didn't deny that they had to pay people off. Then in 1969, there was a professor from the University of Miami by the name of Henry Truby, and he published the fact that the new and old Paul have different voice prints, sonograms, proving again that they cannot be the same person, since each voice print is unique, like each fingerprint. Now, this is in the book. It's also on the website, billyshears.com. And the songs that Dr. Truby looked at were Yesterday versus Penny Lane, and then Yesterday and Hey Jude, and they were completely different voices. And at that point, it was published in Life magazine, I think in November, and they thought the gig was up. It was published in a major magazine. This professor had proven that the voice prints are different. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. No, nobody grabbed onto it. So remember I was talking about people want to see what they want to see? It's almost like people want to hear what they want to hear also, right? So that's another situation. So we had Sam the reporter. We had the voice print analysis by Dr. Henry Truby. And then this one gets very interesting. And you may remember this, maybe not. But those that followed Bill Shepard as McCartney in his solo career will remember that he got arrested in Japan in 1980. For pot possession. And this was after he had worked out an arrangement with the Japanese government based on prior drug arrests. So he had made commitments that, you know, never going to happen again, so on and so forth. And so he admits in the book that he didn't want to be told what to do. He was wealthy. He was Paul McCartney. He was this, he was that, pounding his chest. So he packed some pot into his bags. Japanese, of course, find the pot and they interrogated him. And they figured out that he was not Paul McCartney, but an imposter. And they had interrogated him for 2 days. They had received his fingerprints from Interpol, and there were different fingerprints than the ones they had when they fingerprinted him in Japan. So they said to him, "Who are you?" He says, "I'm Paul McCartney." They said, "Well, you're not Paul McCartney. Don't tell us you're Paul McCartney. We know you're not. You're an imposter. What are you doing?" And they accused him of forging passports and of being a government agent. He spent 9 days in jail until, now get a load of this, the way he got out of jail, the UK government and Scotland Yard interceded. And I mean, the downside of this for Bill is he had to cancel his Japanese concert tour, of which Denny Lane was extremely upset about. I guess, you know, the money and everything else. But the thing that got me was the UK government and Scotland Yard interceded. They got him out of Japan. And what does that tell you?
Well, that backs up your statement that he was worth a lot to the British government.
Right.
So was he there on his own or was he there with the Beatles?
He was there with his band Wings. This was post-Beatles. Oh. Post-Beatles.
Yeah.
So he was there with his wife, Linda. He had Denny Lane, right? And so they had to go home. And, you know, he's sitting in the clink for 9 days in Japan being interrogated. And they know it's not him. They know he's not Paul McCartney.
Well, that's a very interesting development. But once again, that didn't get that far, right?
No.
It didn't.
No. It got buried. I guess it got buried between the Japanese and the British government. I mean, nothing came out. I mean, the only way I know about this is it's in the book. I knew he had gotten arrested in Japan, and I remembered that he had spent 9 days in jail for possession of pot, but I had no idea that all this went on. I had no idea that they were comparing fingerprints, that Interpol was involved, that he was accused of being, you know, of forging passports and being a government agent. I didn't know any of that. I'm reading his book, and I started laughing. I'm thinking to myself, this is unbelievable. Nobody heard any of this after that, back in 1980, so I'm just going to assume that the UK government and the Japanese government shook hands on it, and that was that.
Yeah, and how do we know that it didn't have input from Sony Corporation? I mean, the Japanese make a tremendous amount of electronics, keyboards, yeah, guitars, Yamaha, and they all say, we can't have a very, you know, popular music figure exposed like this. We want endorsements from people in music. We can't have music shown to be fraudulent, right?
Right. That's right.
I mean, this is big business too. We can't just relegate it to governments.
Yeah. So the fourth biggie is a paternity suit that started back in 1982. And he had a relationship with a lady by the name of Erica Hubers when he was in Hamburg, Germany. We're talking about the biological Paul now, not Bill Shepard. This is the biological Paul. So this goes back to 1962. And it was a pretty long relationship, 18 months. It wasn't a one night stand. And the relationship was well established from what I understand. You know, there were pictures of the two of them together and so on. And so out of that relationship, a daughter was born. Her name was Bettina, B-E-T-T-I-N-A, Bettina Hubers. And back then, child support was agreed to by biological Paul McCartney, the real Paul McCartney. And Shepard, as Paul McCartney, as the character Paul McCartney, also paid the child support because it was contractual. So he continued the child support obligations put in place by biological Paul McCartney. However, as we know, with child support, it runs out after a certain age. You know, you don't have to make any payments anymore. So Bill Shepard, because he wasn't the father, but he's reaping all the benefits of being Paul McCartney. This is the other thing that got me, to be honest with you. Some people will probably argue with me on this. I mean, I see his point. He's not the one who fathered the child. But on the other hand, he's the guy running around playing the guy who fathered the child. And so there was a lawsuit, paternity lawsuit, and Bill Shepard had to submit DNA, and the DNA did not match. And I guess they were matching the DNA against Bettina's DNA. Now, this became very, very sticky because Erica Huber's, the mother, was very, very adamant. Two things happened. One was, she was looking at pictures of Bill Shepard, and she said, "That's not Paul McCartney." And she was making a lot of noise about this. And then what happened was he signed a document, and when he, because he's right-handed, well, he signed the document, and it was, when he signed it with a right-handed lean or tilt. She looked at the signature and said, "It's not his signature." So then what happened was they had to go to some Beatle museum. I mean, this is really unbelievable. And they compared the handwriting. And they concluded it was not the same handwriting. So the signatures did not match.
Now, this lawsuit was in 1982,
In
and
the
yet the biological Paul and his relationship dated back to 1962 with Erica Hubers, right?
Yeah. So I'm assuming what happened was the paternity lawsuit. So when you figure when, so the child support started in 1962, let's say. So let's just say it went till she was about 18 years old, right? So that takes you to around 1980. And it was at that point, I guess, that the Hubers decided that, you know what? You're worth like, a gazillion dollars. And this is your child. And you're just going to stop the checks after the child support? I don't think so. So they fired up the paternity suit, and he was sued for fraud. And but I tried to find out what happened with that case. I'm not sure if it's still active or not.
Well, I guess we could try to put someone on that, a scout, and see what happened. But I suppose that, she would inherit, she would, but again, there's that division. If it's not his child, he wouldn't want to. But for the sake of appearances, this would be the right thing, the only thing to do, right? And
And what he's,
disinherit somebody.
and what he says in the book is that he's going to let the DNA do the talking. That's it. So, based upon that position, she's out of the money because the DNA is not going to match. I mean, they already know that.
Well, he's established that he is the one who is responsible for the Beatles' success. He's not alluding to the fact that his role was is a manufactured role because it's part of the design of society. So it's not just that he's responsible, he's the most talented and he took over and so forth. It's that, again, he was chosen to do this. So yeah, I mean, you can disinherit anybody you want, but it doesn't make you look good, doesn't make you popular out there, right?
No, it looks very dull. And the thing is, he had to make a decision. I know it makes me look dull, but do I care? Or how much do I care? And apparently, I guess, he believes he cared enough to continue the child support payments, and that was that.
So all those years, Erica thought that she was getting money from the real Paul, or do you think she was onto it? Do we have any clue?
No, she thinks she was getting it from the real Paul. They have no idea that Paul McCartney died in 1966. They thought that Bill Shepard, the guy playing Paul McCartney, was the same guy back that got her mother pregnant back in 1962.
Well, I mean, she knows now, and this has been going around for a while, and there's the book and our interview, so.
Well, he even says in the book, he says, Bettina, if you're reading this book, he goes, now you understand. He says that in the book. That's not going to make Bettina feel any happier, but
Well,
so.
what is driving him now that the listeners understand a little more and I do? At almost age 80, I mean, that's what happens to a lot of people. As they get very old, they need to start rectifying, correcting the record. So is that what he's doing here? Do you
Yes, that's exactly what he's doing. And think about it, Sophia. This man, like I said, whatever anybody thinks about what we're talking about here, put him in a good light, bad light, indifferent, whatever. You cannot take away from the fact that this man is extremely talented. He's a brilliant, brilliant musician and songwriter. But he's a brilliant songwriter, and his fame and fortune came as Paul McCartney, not Bill Shepherd. So, I mean, you could ride the Paul McCartney gravy train for so long, and I guess after a while it starts to get to you. Nobody knows who the hell Bill Shepherd is. Paul McCartney didn't write these songs. Paul McCartney didn't write Sgt. Pepper. Paul McCartney didn't write the songs on Abbey Road, the songs on the White Album. He didn't write the songs on Let It Be. He didn't write the songs on Yellow Submarine. He didn't write the songs on Magical Mystery Tour. I did. He didn't write Band on the Run. You know? And I guess after a while, like you said, you know, you want to set the record straight. He's pushing 80 years old now. And it's like, hey, you know what? I want to get my due. William Wallace Shepherd did all this stuff, not Paul McCartney. But he's his own worst enemy, right? He bought into this. He contracted.
He may not have had that much choice either. I mean, it may have been a bigger design than the Beatles and Bill Shepherd. And yes, I know what you're saying, that your real self starts to bleed through.
Right.
This happens with the MK Ultra people too, that the older they get, the more their alters start to fail and the real self pops up and goes, wait a minute, where am I in all this? And so that may be his reason for writing the book, that his real self says, give me some recognition. And that the ability, the human ability of his walk-in didn't come close to his natural talents and human ability. So that is something that you want to die having it recognized, I guess.
Right. So I don't want to take up too much more time, Sophia. This is, we're up against 2 hours, but there's a couple other slides I'd like to take you through, if that's okay.
Yes, that's absolutely fine. I mean, you can make this as long as you want. Absolutely.
Okay.
As long as you want.
Okay. So let's move to what I refer to as other clues, and that would be on my slide 14. So here's something that bugged me a little bit. I have to be honest with you. Virtually every Beatles song, beginning with the songs on Sgt. Pepper, has to do with the death of Paul McCartney. So there's double meaning of the lyrics. There's backmasking, which, you know, where they sing backwards. It's a play the record backwards. That's the whole Revolution Number 9, Turn Me On, Dead Man, and stuff like that. And I thought originally that it was select songs, but he goes through an enormous number of songs and breaks it down, and the lyrics and how the lyrics apply to the death of Paul McCartney and how it's all tied into Paulism and all that stuff. So everybody knows about Strawberry Fields, right? Most people do. At the end, John says, I buried Paul. And, you know, he used to say, I didn't say that. I said cranberry sauce, but it was ridiculous. He said, I buried Paul. The song While My Guitar Gently Weeps is about Bill Shepherd and the swapping out of Paul McCartney. Let It Be, Glass Onion, I'm So Tired, A Day in the Life, Hey Bulldog, of all songs. It's a rocker on Yellow Submarine. Revolution Number 9 is the obvious one, because that's the one where it, if you play it backwards, it says, Turn Me On, Dead Man. All You Need Is Love. And on and on and on. And so I slumped a little bit in my chair when I was reading that, because I thought to myself, all these years, I've been listening to these songs. I listened to All You Need Is Love as an example. And I'm interpreting it this way. In the meantime, yes, you can interpret it that way. That's not a problem. But the thing was, there was this alternate meaning to the song. And it had to do with the occult. It had to do with, the, you know, what they refer to as Paulism. That bugged me, I have to be honest with you. When the Beatles formed Apple Corps, the corporation, when you look at the word Apple Corps, Corps is C-O-R-P-S, corpse. Right? It's a play on words. A Paul corpse. A Paul corpse. Apple Corps. Okay? So that's something else. He brings it up in the book. He talks about it. That's not my interpretation. He mentions that. Now, here's some interesting things for people, and I will put this in the show in the end. There is footage, video footage, film footage, of John Lennon and George Harrison and a couple other folks at John Lennon's house when he was recording the album Imagine. And this was, I think the name of the video was, or the film was, The Making of the Imagine Album, something to that effect. But there is dialogue there at the table where they're sitting there eating, and Yoko's pouring some, you know, some tea. And John says, so he's talking to George, and he says, we have a Beatle wife making tea for the Fab Four. So George doesn't miss a beat, says Fab Three. So John goes, yes, Fab Three. And then George starts to talk about Beatle Bill and calls him Beatle Bill. And in the book, he mentions that that was his nickname. He used to call him Beatle Bill. And so I'm going to put that clip and you guys can watch that. It's there's no question about it. It's not like, you have to kind of like listen closely. George calls him Beetle Bill. Also, there's an interview that George did. I think it was an Australian interview back in the 1980s, and there was a lot of still a lot of tension. And in that interview, George is calling Paul McCartney Fall. And he does this two or three times during like a 6-minute interview, calls him Fall McCartney. So I'll put that in there and you can listen to that. It's clear as day. Here's another one that's very interesting. And by the way, the next one I'm going to talk about, he calls it out in the book.
Well,
There's a
let's
movie.
just cover this fall. Fall is false Paul.
Right, fake Paul, false Paul, right. So Paul, fake Paul or false Paul is Fall. Now, there was a movie that Bill Shepard did back in 1984. It was released in 1984, called Give My Regards to Broad Street. It was not a very good movie, but be that as it may, there's a scene where McCartney, the character McCartney, is introduced as William in a recording studio scene from the movie. Now, do I think that was by accident? No. I think what happens is they're basically just dropping these little clues. It's like the clues are in the album. That was a little clue that was dropped in that particular movie. On the Beatles anthology album, and he mentions this in the book also, and I found it. It was DVD disc number 7, so if you're going to take a look at it, it's 50 minutes in. He's playing right-handed. Now, when I analyze this, he is indeed playing right-handed, but I think what they did was, I think he was playing left-handed and they mirrored the video, so it made him look like he was playing right-handed. Now, why did they do that? Obviously, somebody intentionally had to do that. And I think, again, that was a wink and a nod. It's another clue. I believe he was playing left-handed when it was filmed in India at the time. Then when they did the anthology, they mirrored or flipped the video, so it made it look like he was playing right-handed. And then as it goes to another scene where he's playing left-handed again. So I think that again was another one of those. Here's another clue for you all, the walrus is Paul. There are videos on YouTube, there's two or three of them where McCartney's playing drums right-handed. And some people might say, well, there are left-handed drummers that play right-handed. Ringo Starr is an example. Ringo's left-handed but plays right-handed. And I will give you that. Yes, there are left-handed drummers that play right-handed. However, there are also far more left-handed drummers that play left-handed. And Bill sure looks very comfortable playing right-handed when he's playing drums. Bill Shepherd's son, James, who's known as James McCartney, looks very much like Bill Shepherd, especially as he was playing the character Vivian Stanshall. That was one of his aliases, one of the characters that he played. One of the things I should mention about Bill Shepherd, Sophia, is that he's quite a character. He likes to dress up, he likes to be in character, he likes to play different personalities. He's a showman. He's an actor. And you can actually go onto YouTube, you can type in Vivian Stanshall, and you can see some of his acts. You can see he's very, very comfortable in front of the camera. Very comfortable. There's nothing awkward about him whatsoever.
Why were so many of those songs centering on the death of Paul? Was that a, it was because it was such a seminal thing in Beatles history, or they were obsessed with it, or it was morbid, or why?
I think it's all of those things. It was a seminal moment. I think the remaining Beatles, basically, that was their way of maybe not forgetting him. But to be honest with you, I think at the end of the day, I think it had more of an occult reason, and I think more of an occult reason, especially with Bill Shepherd. So this was basically a way of continuing to stay connected to the biological Paul that is no longer in physical form. So, this was a constant, think of it as like a constant, it's almost, I hate to say this because it's not, it pains me to say this, but it's almost like a constant ritual.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
To keep the connection. I hate saying stuff like that. I'll tell you, it pains me, folks, so much because, like Sophia said, maybe I should take a picture of my room. Put it in the video and you could see, but I think it was all those things, Sophia, but I think the occult aspects of it were front and center.
Well, it makes you wonder, what else they constantly connect to in this way of theirs. Because all of their societal engineerings are coming from this very deep interdimensional place. That's what I now think. And they keep it going. They keep feeding that fire.
No, you're right. That's exactly what they're doing. Now, I want to take you through two more things here, and then I promise I'll wrap up. But I haven't seen anybody else do this, so I'm going to explain this to the folks. I will put the charts in the slideshow, so you can see what I'm talking about. But if we go to chart 15, what I did, Sophia, was I wanted to take a look at the numerology. Even though he says in the book that numbers don't mean that much to him, you know that's not true, because if he's a high-ranking Mason, then numbers are very important. They rule by numbers, symbols and numbers. So what I did was I took a look at two moments in time. One was biological Paul McCartney's birth and biological Paul's death. So after going through several iterations of working the numbers, here's how it played out. Biological Paul was born in June of 1942, so June is the sixth month of the year. Biological Paul died in 1966 on September 11th. He was 24 years old. 2 + 4 is 6. So now we have the month of June, his date of birth, 6. His age when he died, 2 + 4, 6. Now we have 6, 6. We just need one more 6 to make it 666. The date, 9/11/1966, when you do the numerology and you play the numbers out, it reconciles to 6. So Paul McCartney, biological Paul, date of birth, his age, and the date that he died, when you play all those numbers out, 666. So let people kind of just chew on that a little bit. Now, the second analysis that I did was I took a look at two turnkey albums, Please Please Me, which is the Beatles' first release, and then, of course, Sgt. Pepper, because Sgt. Pepper was the first album that had Bill Shepherd as Paul McCartney, and Please Please Me was the first album which Biological Paul was on the album. So those are the two points in time. If I take a look at the release date of Please Please Me, it was March 22nd, 1963. March being the third month of the year, the day was the 22nd day, so 3 × 22 is 66. So now we have two sixes of 666. Sgt. Pepper was released on June 1st, 1967. So if we apply the same approach to the numerology, if I take the month times the day, 6 × 1 is 6. There's the third 6. So Please Please Me, March 22nd, 3 × 22 is 66. Sgt. Pepper, June 1st, 6 × 1 is 6, 6, 6, 6. Now, coincidence? I don't think so, based upon everything else that we've covered in this discussion. Very interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, I was looking at that when you sent it. And I mean, you've really been diligent, Mike, in putting this numerology together and all these other clues as well. And the, Brian Epstein dying just short of his 33rd birthday. It's very sad in a way that
It's very sad.
these numbers to manipulate the lifespans of people and
And George Harrison was all about the number 11. Well, Harrison, I went and took a look at George Harrison, because George Harrison was attacked at his home in Friar Park back in 1999. And I said, well, let me just take a look at the numbers on that. So what I did, Sophia, just quickly, we'll go to slide 18. Again, folks, I'll put this in the slideshow. If you go to slide 18, this is an actual article that was written 15 years afterwards. So they recapped what happened. So they said, George Harrison was attacked at home on December 30th, 1999. December 30th. So December is 1 and 2. 1 plus 2, that's 3. The 30th, 3. 33. So we have the 33rd degree of Freemasonry. Then we also have the 33 again, because they said at approximately 3:30 a.m., 3:33, Michael Abram, a 33-year-old native of Liverpool, avoided security by jumping the fence at Harrison's Friar Park estate and attacked George Harrison when he was sleeping. So I have 33 in the date, 33 based upon the time of the attack, 33 is the age of the attacker, George Harrison was 56 at the time. 5 plus 6 is 11. Remember, when I look at his date of his death, which was November 29th, November is 11. 2 plus 9 is 11. So we have 11, 11. And last but not least, to round out the article, they talk about John Lennon dying on December 8th. Well, December 8th, we take the December, 1 plus 2 is 3, plus the 8 is 11. So we have the number 11. So the numbers 11 and 33, as we have found with many, many other events, Sophia, is extremely pervasive, extremely pervasive. So, you know, doing all this and taking a look at all this stuff, you can only conclude that this entire saga, this whole Paul is dead conspiracy, which is, as far as I'm concerned, is we can pack it away, put it away, it's done. We have been listening to and looking at Bill Shepard for 50 years, is cloaked and soaked in Masonic deception and ritual. The whole thing. The whole thing.
Mike, can I ask a dumb question?
Sure.
Why did Harrison get attacked at home at age 56 by a 33-year-old and so forth? Was it an intention to take him out of this life or just scare him and keep him in line or what? Because this looks like, with all the numbers you just gave us, it looks like it wasn't just, you know, some guy who said, oh, I think I'll go down the road and do this.
I think that, I'll give you my opinion on this, it's really not covered in the book. I believe that both he and John Lennon breached the Masonic oath or obligations, if you will. And let me explain why. We'll work with George first. George was becoming more and more open, calling him Fall, calling him Beetle Bill. And the problem with that is it's one thing to put clues in your albums and have people kind of like wonder and ponder. And then when you're asked about it, because the Beatles were asked about it, they denied it. They just said, oh, it's crazy. You know, I didn't say that. Oh, you're reading into things. Oh, it just happened to play out that way. But when you start talking about it, so I think that it's possible that George Harrison had just gotten completely fed up with the whole thing. And he started to be more vocal about it. And that's something he shouldn't have done in the eyes and the minds of the people that are controlling this, right? So I think they were sending him a little wake-up call. Shut your mouth. Shut your mouth. Lennon, on the other hand, started his backpedaling on this whole thing when he returned his MBE, because the Beatles had received their MBEs from the Queen. And I think 2 or 3 years after he had received his, he put it in an envelope and he mailed it back to the Queen and said, thank you, but no thank you. And then he had become a tremendous, tremendous thorn in their side with the whole...
What's an MBE again?
Oh, that's the Order of the British Empire. It's rewarding contributions to the arts and sciences, work with charitable and welfare organizations and public services outside the civil service. Basically what it is, it's service to the crown. You're doing a good job, boys. Doing a good job.
Yeah. Right? I just wondered what it stands
yeah,
for.
Yeah, yeah, nope, no problem. I'll make sure I put that in the slideshow also so people know. And John returned his. And then after, you know, John returned his, he had become very, very vocal about the anti-war movement, and he had become extremely anti-establishment, and the Nixon administration hated him. They were, you know, they wanted to deport him. He had just become a handful, quite honestly, because of his notoriety, his popularity. He was a real problem for them. You know, that's why, in my view, that John Lennon was taken out. Now, he had gone into remission, if you will. He was doing his house husband thing for a while, and then he was coming out. And I believe that what happened was, again, this is me surmising, Lennon was coming out of retirement, if you will, at the age of 40. And when he was coming out of retirement at age 40, he had matured a lot. John was hot-tempered. You know, he could be erratic. You'll read a lot about this, people who knew him when he was in the Beatles and his post-Beatle era. And then, you know, he had settled down and he was coming out as a father, having solidified a family. He was coming out of retirement with a completely different perspective now. So what was he going to do? Well, was he going to talk to all of the 40-year-olds now and people who are in their 50s and say he had a different message And where was that message going to go? So I think what happened was they said, you know, we're not even going to go there. We're not even going to like even guess where he's going to take this. He just needs to go. And that's what I think happened with John Lennon. Those are my thoughts on it.
Well, they make sense, Mike. And, you know, once again, it reminds all of us that even the most enviable people in the world have a lot to be mindful of, and they don't get to choose their paths of destiny by any means. It's that's what I find to be the real, you know, joke on everyone. And it's sad that they have built up the society to be fawning over people like Beyonce and the Kardashians, right, and you know, the rappers and the movie stars. And it's just incredible that there can be this kind of adoration, and yet at the depths of it there is so much dark, morbid control, to the point that these aren't free souls at all. They may have a lot of money, they may be attractive and receive all this glory, but they are the most modulated people among us, really, much more than we are even.
Oh, absolutely. They're completely controlled, and you know, and like you said, Sophia, at the end of the day, they have all this money and they have all this celebrity and this notoriety, but they are owned, and they pay a price for that. You know, Paul McCartney paid a price for that. George Harrison paid a price for that. John Lennon paid a price for that. And at the end of the day, Bill Shepard may even pay a price for that, because God only knows, you know, even though, you know, he believes that what he's doing is the right thing and he's brought a lot of good music and happiness to a lot of people. But, you know, somebody could question the way in which he went about doing that. Was that a good way to do it? I mean, I don't know, you know?
Mike, you did a very good job, and I really appreciate this now much more. And I don't know, would you tell people to buy the short book or the long book or both books? How would you make a recommendation if people want to get either of those?
Well, I would say that if your interest in this is you're interested, but you know, you're not like deep into Beatle history or, you know, the Beatle research, then go with the book, Billy's Back. That's the 250-page book. There's a lot of stuff in here, and you will definitely get enough out of this book where it ices the deal for you. If you want to do what I did, which is to understand a lot more about what is really behind all this, and what I mean by that is the occult and all that stuff, then you're going to definitely want to get the big book. It's 666 pages, 666, and it's called The Memoirs of Billy Shears, and the author / encoder is a guy by the name of Thomas E. Uharriot. It's also, by the way, I should mention this, and I didn't mention it, he contains a chapter in here, it's a very brief chapter, where he includes a letter, a correspondence with his attorney. Everything in this book had to be run by attorneys to make sure he didn't breach his contracts. Can you imagine that?
Yeah, I can imagine it. I mean,
unbelievable. 666 pages. So this was an enormous undertaking. And by the way, he explains that he's unbelievably wealthy. Unbelievably wealthy. Beyond anybody's wildest dreams. Very, very wealthy man.
Well, Mike, I mean, I don't know if people want to be that wealthy at the expense of their true, real origins.
Yeah.
You know, we live very different lives than these people, and I think we should be grateful for our lives. We have a lot more semblance of us left to us to do what we want with, even though we don't live in a free world by any means, etc., etc. But would you like to be Billy Shears or William Shepherd or anyone like that? Would you like to have been John Lennon, George Harrison, Ringo Starr? I mean, who wants to be these people?
Right. What's displayed on the outside is so far away from what's really going on internally in the inner circle. Think about it. You know, Ringo hasn't said boo. He can't. I mean, he can't. Can you imagine every day? I mean, he knows, obviously he knows the score. And he's got two former friends that are dead. And another guy that's been an imposter for 50 years. You know, that's it. You know, do your thing.
They're famous for A sham. That's really what it boils down to. They're famous for a sham. They went down in history for participating in this huge sham. Now, come on. That's how I see it.
I have to tell you, Sophia, that I saw it the same way. I try to, get my head wrapped around the aspect that the music was still the music. It's great music. There's no doubt about it. Unbelievable music. But I keep going back to, but how did it get there? What was the mechanism? Like I mentioned before, what was the engine that drove this? And that's where, I just shake my head. It made me realize that, you and I have talked about this many times offline too, that just about everything that's worth knowing is a lie. And even the things that maybe bring you joy in life, or things that make you happy, or, when you really understand, or if you bother to understand how those things were created and how it is that they are, it can be extremely disturbing. I don't want to end on a bummer note here. I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but those thoughts crossed my mind.
Well, I'll just say something, this little story from my childhood. I think I was about 11 or 12, and I just had my piano lesson, and I had a kind of advanced level of piano. I had a teacher from a conservatory, and he was a real classical musician, pianist, and this is what he did. This was his life. And I was not into classical music as much because I was young, but I knew I had to. This is what I had to learn. This is what I had to practice. So no sooner had he gotten up out of his chair and he was leaving, I jumped up and I put on Let It Be by the Beatles. And it was the Let It Be album with that song. And it starts out with chords of the piano, right?
Right.
And I was happy to hear it because this represented more my kind of music. And my piano teacher just turned around and looked at me and made this most awful face. My mother was there and he said, "That is terrible music. Oh." And that stayed with me forever. So I was never a Beatles fan because of the look on his face. So there you go. It's not great music according to some.
Yeah, I know. I have delved into the Beatle music, the actual craftsmanship of the songwriting and stuff like that, and the engineering aspects of it, the production, George Martin's part and everything else. It taught me everything that I know today, I want to say, about songwriting. And it certainly was, the Beatles were the reason why I picked up a guitar. There's no doubt about it. I remember as a kid going to go see Yellow Submarine in 1968. In a movie theater on Long Island, and I was 9 years old, So after reading this, it's a little bit of a shock.
Yeah, it's like people who read the Dave McGowan book. I was getting emails after I did that interview with Dave, and people bought his book, and they were friends of mine. They listened to my podcast, and they wrote the emails of such enormous devastation. That an entire era of their life was wiped out by knowing this material. And so, all my sympathies go to all of us. I was just lucky that that piano teacher made that face for me, dashed like everyone else has been.
Oh, man. Well, I didn't get that look. I'm still sitting with the Beatles as we speak, so. With a different perspective, however, a much different perspective.
Well, thank you, Mike. Thank you for all the diligence that you put into this and the patience with my questions. I hope this interview was enlightening for people, and everyone will be all right. Tomorrow is a new day. We don't have to hang on to the past, the shreds of it. We can just wake up and we can start all over.
Yes. It's fairly fresh. This is actually a Beatle wife fixing the tea for one of the Fab Four ex-Beatles.
Fab Three.
See Beatle Bill making a pig of himself.
Not doing so well these days, is he, Beatle?
Well, he's number five in Sweden.
Oh, in Sweden, that's it.
It
It's hard for Australians, I'm sure, when you think of the Beatles' tours to Australia, it's hard for an Australian to believe that you three guys who remain don't get on.
We all have concepts of each other, you know?
I don't expect you to go into the finances of it, the details, but is it really, you know, question over $1 million or $100 million? Is that the sort of thing?
It's not really to do with anything like that. It's the personal problem Paul had, which was not actually his problem, it was mine and Ringo, because of what the history should show. As soon as we do that, Paul will be free of any problem he may have of us, because I don't have time to screw around anymore, you know?
During the coverage of the divorce case, they've been saying that you want 50 million, and the reason it's stalled.
I have been offered nothing, okay?
Okay.
Nothing. We go to court, nothing to do with that. We go to court over my daughter. I'm not allowed to talk about it because it's a criminal act if I talk about my daughter. You have no idea what's going on. These figures are made up, 100 million, 50 million, 20 million, this million. How do you know if I even want any money? I'm 1.5 million in debt in lawyer's fees. Right. And that's as much as I can say, or I go to jail for telling the truth. So I'm gagged at the moment because I'm not allowed to say a word while the media are fed this spin by a certain corner.
All right, but then again, and as I say, I only know it from the media, so what do I know? But one of the clauses apparently in this whole divorce thing is that you want to be able to sell your story. And then again,
it's
people...
It's rubbish! Right, okay. I could sell my story right now! I'm trying to protect Paul and our daughter. I am trying, and I'm being pushed to the edge.
You know why I've left you. Protect me, and I will say nothing. Something so awful happened. Someone I'd loved for a long time, I found out, had betrayed me immensely. And I don't mean infidelity or anything like that. Like, beyond belief.
So somebody betrayed you, and of course everyone here is going to believe that that's Paul McCartney, in a way, not infidelity, that is so much deeper than that. It wounded you and pushed you towards suicide.
Yeah, it did. And he knows that.
So it's Paul.
But I've got to protect myself. I have to protect myself. People don't want to know what the truth is because they could never, ever handle it. They would be too devastated.
Toward the end of the 60s, is that when the rumors about you being dead surfaced? Do you remember that? Do you remember remember how that started? What were your feelings about that?
What happened? My feelings. Yeah, no, what happened was we did a cover for a record called Abbey Road, and we... See, even the cover gets applause. and the idea was to walk across the crossing, and I showed up that day with sandals, flip-flops, and so it was so hot that I kicked them off and walked across barefooted. So this started some rumour that because he was barefooted, he's dead. I couldn't see the connection myself.
No, I don't. It seemed like a long, slow, difficult death. Being barefooted will kill you.
Scorched feet.
And what do you? How do you manage something like that? Because it was a global rumor. And
yeah. I mean, you know, I just laughed at it and knew it was just because of the fame and the craziness. It was an American DJ, so you guys are to blame.
Yeah.
Not you personally, but... No, the thing is, you know, I just laughed it off, but it was a little bit strange because people did start looking at me like...
Right.
Is it him or a very good double?
Well, that was the idea. That was the other part of it, that there was a guy who looked like you taking your place.
No, well, this is him.
Yeah. Or is it?
Hi, this is Sophia encouraging you to visit my online store, avatarproducts.com, where you will find a wonderful thing called magnesium cream. Magnesium is a mineral we desperately need due to the fact that it alkalinizes our blood and, another bonus, it relaxes muscles. So all you athletes or computer addicts with workout soreness or stiff necks, use a little magnesium cream on a regular basis and feel the kinks getting looser. Magnesium is the dominant ion in the cell and facilitates hundreds of biochemical exchanges. Using it transdermally through the skin means you can put it right on those chronic pain spots and it still gets absorbed to work systemically. A 3-ounce tube is easy to carry around and a great gift for aging parents, introducing them to natural chemistry for rapid pain relief for arthritis and joints, and great overall cellular support. It's at avatarproducts.com in the sun and skin section.